everyone, and a very good evening. I hope I can wake you up with this presentation. I know it's been a long day. And very quickly, I want to just talk a little bit about the practice, give you a little introduction. So the setup by three of us, Amrish, Siddharth, and myself, and we've been growing. We are a 50-strong team now of multidisciplinary practice of people with skills in interior design, architecture, furniture design, communication design. Quickly, I want to just walk you through the kind of work we do, the domains we work in. From boutique retail, these are stores for Manav Gangwani, Gaurav Gupta at Emporio. So translating their brand identities into retail spaces. We've also done work for larger brands like Fast Track, where we've helped them translate their brand ethos into a retail environment. And even iconic brands like Royal Enfield, when it's turning its face around. These are some recent transformations that we've been working with brands on. In F&B segments, from very small players like Independence Brewery, who's into the segment of craft brewing, to even international brands like Jamie Oliver, we've helped them set up a new F&B chain by the name of Pizzerias, which is being launched now internationally. We've done 3 stores in India. Some pro bono work, like the crafts at the Crafts Museum, their store and the Cafe Lota. For the Coach Foundation, we've worked on this building for them, which it's a foundation that helps upcoming artists. Urban City House, an interior from a residence on Aurangzeb Road. Conceptual sketch for a building that we're working on in the Kunur Hills. A lot of you might be familiar with this project. This is in the segment of hospitality. This won us the WAF award in 2011. That's a new project we are working with for the Taj Group, again in Himachal. That's for the Antara Group. I'll move quickly here. These are new projects, which large-scale projects which are coming up in Mumbai for Godrej. So quickly coming to the topic that I wanted to speak about today. I've chosen this because this is something that really guides our work, and I thought it kind of gives you an insight into why we make our decisions the way we do, and what really excites us, what inspires us. So just to give you a little insight into what we mean by this for us, you know, creating meaning gives us opportunities to really question norms, turn things around, have new conversations around things. And I'm going to talk about this using 3 projects to try and demonstrate this. In fact, the last panel discussion was really interesting because that's one of the things that we like to look at when we speak about collaboration. We really go all the way out. I mean, starting with a partner, we try and convert, starting with a client, we try and get into a partnership with him when we sit down to design, rather than having an across the table conversation. And all the way, of course, the design team, the technical team, consultants, all the way down to people who are executing. We really try and work hand in hand with them. And we believe that that is what really brings the kind of projects and the outcome that we are being able to achieve. And context is really important, which again, I'll try and show how we've used context and celebrated it in our own way. It really helps us make it meaningful for everybody, every stakeholder that participates in the process with us. Like for example, when we worked on RAS, we actually could influence the local stone craft and had an impact on transforming the skill, the workers there. They really feel proud about what they've been able to create. It's a contemporary expression, but using the skills which were locally around. So that's very satisfying as a practice. So quickly, I want to walk you through 3 projects. The first project I'm taking is RAS Kangra. That's a resort that's coming up in the hills near Dharamshala. And the site context is, it's about 30 kilometers from Dharamshala. It's overlooking the Dholadhar range. So it's an interesting site where we have a strip of land, which is a barren piece of land on a large tea estate. So on one side, you have views to the Dholadar. On the other side, the tea estate. And one of the key questions that we asked when we started the project was, like, what does a resort really mean? Does a resort need to, does a resort only mean villas and cottages? I mean, that's a conventional way of looking at it. That was a brief that we developed with the client. And we also kind of evaluated what it means for the client when we are talking about the resort, the villa being a superior player. And we came up with a solution which kind of bridged both these aspects and took care of the limitations of the villa. So that's how we reinterpreted the villas. So normally a setup in a resort would mean rooms scattered all over in the villa format. And we kind of looked at creating a spine that would allow for all the common spaces and the circulation to hold together a really long building, a 200 meter long building, and then stack up rooms at the upper level and the lower level below the spine, and the building kind of responds to the contour. And the structural system of the building acts as a spine for vertical circulation. And that's how we sited the building at the edge of the valley, giving us views on the north to the Dholadar and on the south to the tea estate. Of course, for the building form, we looked at the Himachali architecture. And one of the key decisions was to put the rooms, the topmost layer of the rooms, in a very lightweight structure to attend to the seismic zone. So the lower structure is in RCC, and the top structure is also, it helped the pace of the project to move fast in the construction process. And that's a section across the, one of the public spaces, which shows the decks, where you experience the north and the south views. In terms of articulation of the materials, we looked at, you know, it's a controversy, luxury versus spirituality, and how do you address this? It's a conflict in a way. And we looked at this idea of a luxurious monastery and how could you express it in a building form. So, you know, if you take the meditative nature of what a monastery is and transform it, creating that same rhythmic pattern on the building. And then working with local stones, we came up with translations of very crafted, so a lot of prototyping, a lot of explorations, and working with local palettes of materials where we could enhance the quality of the experience by just adding a lot of craft to it. That's how the building elevations kind of evolved. The small detail of the rendered elevation, and I'm going to show you, this building is under construction, so work in progress images of the site, where the translation of the stonework. So that's how the building is coming together. And I have a small film to share with you, the scale and just the setting of this site. Sorry, before that I'll quickly walk you through the villa experience. So for the rooms, what we chose to do was everybody walks into the middle of the room and everybody has a personalized entry to the room. So that was the key idea of creating the villa experience. And your lines of sight to the Dholadar are completely uninterrupted. So you feel like you are in a private private villa. So that's a layout of how the rooms were placed, where we had a bed space, a living space with balconies flanking on both sides. And that's the toilet block with a walk-in wardrobe. I'll walk you through the rooms. That's a sense of entry for each villa, so to say, or sewage room, where we work with these large perforated brass domes, which mark the entrances. And that's your sense of experience coming into the rooms, where you come in the middle of the room, and on the left and right are two different spaces, the wet space, which has a little attic for the kids. And the main dividing screen to the washroom acts as a giant lantern for the room. So where we worked with sandwich glass with tea-stained paper, it's a pattern that's been generated. That's a view of how you experience the building and the setting. The next project is a recent project we finished at Jaipur Palace, and it's recently won at the Inside Awards at the World Architecture Festival. Some of the key conversations that we had before we kind of jumped onto the project were how do you address the skills and what Jaipur wants for as a city. I would focus on the last bit where, you know, it was a very interesting opportunity for us to create a focal point where tourists and the local people could actually mingle. So I'll talk a little more about that, what's really happening in Rajasthan. So basically, the museum really attracts, and actually Jaipur attracts a very large tourist population, and these are the stats on that, and it's one of the largest kind of crowd puller. And the usual interpretations of Rajasthan is a very cliche of the snake charmers and the elephants versus, you know, the locals really aspire. So these are the kind of translations of old palaces and what a heritage used to be, and that repackaged and sold to the new tourists. While the tourists come in and kind of get a flavor of that, the locals really don't aspire to be part of those spaces. They are looking forward to the new developments which are happening around, and they want to be part of that. And how do you kind of bridge this? So that's what we looked at this cusp was an opportunity, and we kind of worked on that. And that's a little bit about the site. That's the Jaipur Palace. That's in terms of the city, how it's located, and that little red spot is where our site is. So on one side it connects to the palace grounds. On the on one edge it kind of opens up to the city. So that was the opportunity we kind of took. That's a view of the courtyard right next to our site, and that's the actual context of the site where Chandar Mahal is the actual residency of the royal family right now, while the rest of it is the larger museum. And a few images of how we found the site. So it was a cafe which was actually catering to the museum, and it didn't really have any other, you know, engagement outside that. So people used to make a trip to the cafe as part of their museum visits. And one of the that was a program we developed with the client. There was a very tight budget, of course, to work on it. So one of the key interventions that we did was look at the circulation. That was the loop of the circulation where you move in and out of the cafe versus what we kind of thought would really help was if there was a direct connection to the city, which would allow for people to move into the premise without entering the museum. So you could almost use the facility outside the purview of the visitors, outside the purview of the museum complex, and it would become more available to the city. So there was an old toilet block which was actually blocking this circulation, and it was a recent construction, so we could engage in a conversation with the client, and against all normal conservation kind of understanding, we could debate about it, and actually we could bring down that block, which made a huge difference to connecting the space and actually creating a seamless courtyard, which we wanted to, again, leave an impression of what was there, or actually create an anchor space which would hold the courtyard together. So we looked at inserting a new device in there. I'll talk about it as we move forward. There were multiple rooms at the ground and the first floor level in this courtyard. Because Jaipur has a very extreme weather, we were also attending to the climatic needs of this cafe. So we had some air-conditioned and non-air-conditioned spaces. But again, the idea was to retain the conditioned spaces in a very small proportion, because the 90% or 70% of the time you're going to be using it in winters. That's where the high tourist season is. And to create a narrative, we looked at authenticity as a base, and we kind of, obviously we were going to work with the local materials. That was one of the drivers for us. But we also looked at what lie beneath the building. So the, you know, the approach to preservation so far has been retain all the frescoes, but the frescoes are really deteriorating in quality as time goes by. And a visit to a neighboring site actually revealed some parts of the palace which were kind of showing the what lied underneath the plaster. We started removing the removing the plasters of the wall and attending to each and every space as it kind of came up. We set up a plant, a lime and mortar plaster plant, close by on the site, and started working on the building, responding to each and every nuance of the architecture, adding some details which were relevant, removing some aspects which we didn't really feel added to the experience. So some very interesting transformations started happening. So that's an old office block which kind of got transformed into a new space for the bar and the lounge. There were some findings, like this old door, almost archaeological in nature, where we kind of refurbished it and used it as part of the detail, part of the new space. The main connecting device, we took inspiration from a Baradri, which a lot of you would know. It's like an open community pavilion. And we placed it in the middle of the site, which would almost become like a jewel. And we also wanted to have a conversation with the old and the new. So the idea was to kind of respond to what was around us and what's relevant today. How do you make it aspirational? So this little jewel, so that's the wall that we removed. And we kind of inserted a pavilion, which in scale responded to the double heights, the different heights of the buildings around. And that's a transformation of that particular space. A little bit about how we went on to creating this pavilion. So there was a lot of crafted details with stone, which we prototyped extensively. We almost brought down the stone thickness to 12 millimeters, and all the stone is inlit, and it's regular marble. So our choice of working with marble was also because we were in Jaipur, and Jaipur is the marble capital of the country. We looked at what skills we had and kind of really interpreted them in contemporary expressions. So fluted marble walls, which kind of helped us line up the central object. We created water bodies and water fountain in the courtyard, which would help as a cooling element. Seating of different natures, fixed, and some mobile seating which would be which easy to on casters, which is easy to move away on parties and large event setups. We also refurbished old floors and reused them by inserting new patterns in those and revitalizing them. Just stone application was looked at more intensely, where we tried using bookmarking as much as possible. Again, all these stones are completely found from the local foundries. Another technique we used was thikri, which we again reinterpreted. Thikri, you know, is a intensive mirror work, fairly traditional, but that was reinterpreted with new artworks and spread across spaces and onto walls, ceilings, transforming spaces and bringing them alive. For the furniture, again, we work with local metal workers and weavers. The entire courtyard has a way of kind of seamlessly opening the air conditioning spaces to the elements. And for that, we again used local MS work, cast brass work, and developed these large doors. A lot of these lamps were developed with Ayush Kaslewal from Jaipur. Very quickly, a finished walkthrough through the project. Some parts of the space we left them as we found them, where there were extensive frescoes. So basically, it kind of creates this whole dialogue between the old and new. So a series of frames and framed views of the old and new from inside to the outside. And the last project I'm going to share is this. It's a Vikrol is going through a lot of replanning, urban replanning, and Godrej found an opportunity to reuse some of its old plant land. I mean, some of its land where they had factories, the oldest factories where they set up their lock plants and soap plants. That's the approach we took. Like, how do we repurpose buildings and tell a story? So that's the broad context. That's the master plan that Godrej is, it's called Trees Development. It's a mixed-use development in Vikhroli. And it's beautiful. It's got really tall rain trees in the campus, and it overlooks the largest mangroves, the last mangroves in Mumbai. And that's the way we found the site. It was full of old plants, generator buildings, glycerin plants, a lot of silos around. And we took this whole approach of how do you create a narrative which would leave a mark and kind of tell a story of what this site used to be, and how do you make it relevant for the new community who's going to be living there, and also think about what is it going to be doing now. So we looked at repurposing the buildings in such a way that they are right now a marketing experience, and later they're going to become anchor points for the community. So these would be converted into F&B experiences, and one part of it is going to be part of a larger hotel complex. So this almost became like a gateway to the community, and that was an initial rendering of how we saw the space. We retained some of the key elements from the site and used them to create markers. So these two buildings were the most important of all, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how we approached the buildings. So we wanted to retain the sense of the essence of the buildings, the fact that they were sheds created for generators, and work with a material palette which would help kind of leave a stain of the life that the building's living. So we looked at materials which would create a patina. Cotton was the choice, where cotton actually, if you know, it's a self-protecting metal. It's an alloy that, but it also tends to kind of, in the process, leave a lot of rust-like stains on the building. And that really became our story for the building, where the rest of the building was articulated in concrete, and the rust layer helps us build this story of the age that the building is going to go through. And that's how we transformed the building. We retained elements like the louvers, but again reinterpreted them. So taking inspiration from the trees and the dappled light that you get from the trees, we actually perforated these large louvers, which do that function of bringing in indirect light into the building during the day. And they act as lanterns in the evening. I mean, the buildings act as lanterns. That's a little step-by-step transformation of how the building moves. Details were chosen from to ensure that that whole construct of the story of the industrial timeless legacy was kind of bound into the building. So all our materials were chosen very specifically so that there was that sense of timelessness. So even the doors are in solid, are paneled in brass to attain that sense of life. And for the interiors of the space, we kind of took a very light approach. We worked with a very amorphic kind of organic form, which helps us break away from the straight lines of the building and create a sense of a temporariness and yet have a very strong presence. We inserted a large silo from the site, and that's actually an AV pod for the marketing experience. And it was lined with brass again, with a lot of detail. That's how the building lights up, and the internal skin becomes a little like a silhouette, a little ghost sitting inside the building. The other building was where we housed the actual sample apartments for the development, sorry. And that was articulated with a large space to allow for events to happen. And we stacked two residential sample apartments on one part of the building and created a gallery to overview the event space, which was modular and allowed for multiple things to happen in that space. We also, in the process, kind of sited, so this was an old boiler which was sitting in the middle of the two buildings, and it was not as planned earlier. But we kind of converted it, reused it as a little cafe. So that's the transformation of the boiler cafe. And we also inserted some elements in the actual walk through the site, which tell a little narrative about the property and what the values are, how they're going to build it up. We used old silos and refurbished them, re-articulated them to create a little museum story for the brand and tell stories about the new development that's coming up. And you know, also use these silos to create garden elements like little benches and spread them around. So yeah, that's a little transformation. And that's when the actual events happen, that's how the plaza kind of comes alive at the moment. And one last film just to again give you a sense.
C'est si bon de partir n'importe où, bras dessus, bras dessous, en chantant des chansons. C'est si bon de se dire des mots doux, de petits rien de tout, mais qui ont dix en langue, en voyant notre mine ravie, les passants dans la rue nous envient. C'est si bon, les passants dans la rue, bras dessus, bras dessus, en chantant des chansons. Quel esprit merveilleux, c'est bon. Je cherche un millionnaire. Voilà, c'est tellement bon.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Raghunath. I'm from Bangalore. I represent Arvindhai Architects. Arvindhai Architects is completely based on eco-friendly architecture, as I was saying. So I would like to go to your resort project, which you're talking about the cottages, villas, they're all scattered and this thing. And you prefer to go with a single block concept. But the reality is, when you go with a villa or cottages, what really happens is, see, the site will be having lots of vegetation. The idea of a resort is to create a hideaway. And it will be easy for you to save the trees and create small blocks in between. But when you go with a single building, you would have lost lots of trees. So how you handled it is what my question
is. So that's why when I started, I said this is a conversation, and we are doing projects where we are doing villas spread out in the landscape. But for this particular project, it was a conversation we had with the clients, and it was a debate that finally ended in a decision which, it made sense because we weighed the pros and cons. I mean, at this point, they felt that there was a lot of advantages they had for the kind of hotel experience that they wanted to run. And absolutely, you're absolutely right. I mean, there's a give and take always, and we made this choice. And that's why I was talking about, we didn't go with a notion that this is how it's meant to be, but we actually had a conversation with the client and said, this is what's going to happen. And then that allowed us to kind of come up with, and there were a lot of other advantages of a dramatic 200 meter long building, which you wouldn't get in a villa experience. So we made a choice. Yeah.
Sorry, because when I saw the site picture, there were lots of trees. In fact, the age of the trees be easily 200 years or something like that. But that particular area where the building is, it looks barren. I'm really sorry to say that. So there are lots of trees.
There are parts of the site which are very graded, which have got the trees. And we deliberately chose a relatively stable part of the site, and which didn't have. And it's actually sitting on a large tea estate, like I said. So the trees are in a very small part of, and it was a barren piece of land. That was the only area where we could build, actually, as per the norms as well. So it was a whole bunch of parameters that helped us arrive at that kind of decision.
Thank you. Thank you. It's great.
We have another question there. One second, sir.
Yeah. Hi, Ankur.
Hi.
It's wonderful to see your work always, and a big fan of your studio. Just wanted to ask you, what are the challenges that you all face as a practice in terms of getting the estimates right up front, because a lot of creative process and thought could be, while the project is going on and could not possibly be conceived up front. I mean, I suppose that's the reality of, creative work. So are you challenged at any stage in getting your, cost projections, estimates right? Do you get pulled up by your clients for, crossing them like the rest of us mortals do? And, and how do you deal with that? And because obviously there is something, that you guys are doing differently.
So to be very honest, I mean, we go through exactly everything you're going through. And most of our projects are fairly driven by costs and budgets. It just takes, I would say, it just takes a lot of work and engagement with the client. And we also fail. We get into, in the middle of projects, we get into conflicts with the client on budgets, and things get into overruns. But we try and find better ways of curbing it. So we're constantly working on, we do a lot of prototyping. So even for contractors, that's how we handhold them or kind of collaborate with them, make sure that they know what they're building, and they would give us a cost estimate that's the closest possible. So to curb cost escalations, that's the best way we've found, where, like, for all our projects, there's a fairly large part of our design process which is prototyping, where we get him to also give us a cost analysis of how he's gone about doing it, which really helps.
All right, we have room for one more question. I believe the gentleman here had a question, sir.
I have used your place, the restaurant in the palace,
okay,
for close to 10 years. I'm an architect, but I used to take groups from America. It was a wonderful place, but not very satisfactory.
Right.
So I'm glad you have done it. And which period you have done it? Just recently?
Very recently, about 6 months.
And briefly, what was the experience with the royalty? Who dealt with you? And the municipality also had something to do with that? Whatever, something interesting you can tell us. I'll use it next time, very soon. Thank you.
So, luckily, I think it didn't fall under any norms. So we didn't have to, and probably the royal family and everybody involved from the client side took care of the norms, so we didn't have to really get into very intense conflicts in that. But of course, there were a lot of conversations, and the royal family and their advisors, they also have an advisor who's advising them on the whole new development. That's so it's part of a larger master plan.
Being very stingy, what they use those things? Royal family. Maybe that changed.
That's not changed. I would say we still work with a really tight budget.